The Philippine economy grew 5.7% in the first quarter of the year, faster than the 5.5% expansion recorded in the final 3 months of 2023. But while the momentum has been sustained, strains are showing, with inflation again accelerating and the central bank keeping its ultra-tight monetary policy. As global and local headwinds continue to emerge, how is the rest of the year shaping up? Let's ask our first guest for his insight. We have Dr. Alvin Ang, the chairperson of the Department of Economics at the Ateneo de Manila University. Okay, so first off, let's start with your reaction to the first quarter GDP growth figures. So it was higher than the fourth quarter growth, but weaker than consensus forecast. Is there anything in the data that was surprising to you?
Actually, our center forecasted it on the dot, the growth. But of course, when you go down to the details, break it down, you'll find that, oh, actually, this didn't go up, this went down too fast. So the surprise there is actually manufacturing. Finally, we had it more than 2% growth. So that quite a bit put up to the weakness also of the services, which have been pulling up growth for the last, 10, 20 quarters. So it's really that the surprise there is manufacturing from the industry side. But from the expenditure side, of course, the decline in household expenditures was much low. It's the slowest growth in household expenditures. But then it's the net exports that, kind of captured that. So if you connect both manufacturing and net exports, that makes you so happy that at least, there is now exports contributing. So we're not just depending so much on services domestically.
I see. So I'm just curious, you talked about the positives. So let's talk about the positives first. So, I guess it was a surprise, manufacturing and exports, but how sustainable do you think are these strong numbers from both ends?
Well, of course, if you go down deep down on manufacturing, you really are talking of just three manufacturing segments. First one is food, which is about 50% of manufacturing, and then another 12 chemicals, and another 12 and a half, 13 computer electronics, the rest. I should say that the food manufacturing, it's dependent on raw material that is at risk right now in terms of price fluctuations around the world. A second round of price increases, not caused by disruptions of the pandemic nor the Russia-Ukraine war in terms of, for example, in the case of wheat. But this time it's the climate, right? So that's where I'm hoping that the manufacturing growth, the raw mats have been there already. I mean, they had stocked it in, but of course the inventory are not so high as well. So you're looking at the sustainability being challenged. But in terms of the growth in electronics, which is actually impressive, that's going to be sustainable. At least that segment. So overall, while the 4.5% growth in manufacturing is a surprise, I would see it normalizing to about 3-3.5 at best because of the challenge of raw materials in agriculture. So that's mm-hmm. the question of sustainability of manufacturing. But definitely the computers, electronics, and the likes, they are the main exports that we are sending. So if there is really good growth over that side, value chain wise, that would continue to be a major source of growth for the country.
Has anything changed actually to lead to the pickup of electronics exports in the country?
Actually, not significant, but what is happening is that the movement of the base manufacturer of electronics to Vietnam kind of made it closer to the Philippines. I guess So the movement of goods of the raw mats coming to the Philippines from the base in Vietnam and in Philippines and re-exported back to Vietnam, Malaysia, and the rest, that lowers the cost of logistics from China.
Okay, so let's now talk about inflation. So of course we're now below 4%, but it has been picking up for 3 straight months now, and we're still seeing the impact of El Nino. How bad could inflation get, and will that continue to hurt consumer spending? Because I think that was one of the main factors that led to the weak first quarter consumer spending numbers.
Yeah, definitely. It's food that's causing that inflation. Well, I'm just happy that it's not kicking so fast. No, it's like it's gradually increasing. But we know, but we can observe from actual prices that the movement of prices is still going up. I mean, particularly rice. From a period of about 6 months, 20% increase. I mean, that's high. And considering that it's almost about 10% of the inflation basket, so that already like gives away, a significant push up. Even if you have, even if you have other segments of inflation relatively staying the same or going down, rice would, would pull up. Even if other food items are not rising, there's that pull up tendency caused by rice. But what I'm not happy, but comforted with is that the oil prices, despite what's happening in the Middle East, is actually compensating each other by the weak demand in China, and then relatively no spike, despite well, a little bit spike, but one day, 2 days, then it's back to where it is. So that stability in the oil price somehow cushions the impact on the increase in food. And since El Nino, it's going to end soon, but the impact, it's like interest rates, the impact is not tomorrow, but it stretches out, especially for example, if the farmers were not able to plant the last 2 to 3 months, then the impact goes 6 months and even beyond, because they're delayed in planting and then harvesting. And same story, and by the way, not only the Philippines, Vietnam, Thailand, in fact, lowered their exports of rice. And so even if we lower the tariff further, if there's no one selling to us, that's another that you know that's the pressure that we're going to see. And I'm really hoping that before the El Nino struck hard in March, that though the planting season in January and February would give us a better harvest this May and June. So hoping that they were there's no major typhoon, right? Fingers crossing tayo dito. We're not really sure, no, but we traveling before after Holy Week, I've seen a lot of harvest already. So by that time, supposedly by this time, they should be in the supermarkets already. That's in a way cushioning the big effect of rice prices all over the region and the world. But still, I think the news is rightly says so. We will be the biggest importer of rice until 2025, assuming there are sellers that will sell that much to us.
So that's it. What do you think of the government 6 to 7% growth target for this year? Is that going to be difficult, or is there a chance that we can reach at least a 6% level?
Well, I we think no, not 7, not 7. That's not that to get that kind of growth, you need to have more surprises from manufacturing, and that agriculture will grow above 3 or 5 or even 5%. No, but that's not going to happen with the kind of structure that we have. So I mean, the best we forecast for the year is that we go back to our steady state growth, which is about 6%. And mo most likely in the second half, that's achievable that you grow faster than six, mainly because of the traditional second half push, right? Local production and even consumption picks up usually at the third, fourth quarter. So, but not beyond 6.3. So, you know, you're just looking at a we observed that the economy had gone back to our steady state. That's the thing. You need serious disruptors that will change that structure to get you out of the 6% growth.
So with that, thank you very much for your thoughts on GDP, inflation, what to expect in the next few quarters. Thank you so much, Alvin, for your
Thank
thoughts.
you. Thank you, April. Thank you. Thank you for having
Okay,
me.
thank you.